Multi-layer perceptron, the concept behind all the neural networks of today, along with its implementation using sklearn library, can be understood through this video. Before getting into the implementation, let's try to understand the components of multi-layer perceptron in detail. It has three layers. Input layer, which is specified in green color, which is specified in orange, or orange-like color is considered to be the output layer. In between these two, you can have any number of hidden layers, which is marked in this blue color. Let us try to understand what input or output and then your hidden layers corresponds to. This is a Google window. I'm typing a word hello. As an end user, I'm giving an input to this Google browser. I'm just pressing enter. That's all. What I'm interested in is the corresponding output. It is throwing different kinds of output as you see. Some could be the song, some could be the video, some could be the images, some could be the text, anything or everything. So it can give any kind of input. Suppose if I choose image, image will be my output. Suppose if I choose video, video will be my output. What is my input? It's just a word. What is my output? It gives so many things. And the interpretation of those things is according to my own understanding. I'm not bothering about what is happening inside, right? After giving my input, how it goes, where it goes, how is it being processed, from where the data is being collected, nothing I am interested with. Only I am interested in knowing the output. The same is the concept here also. The users are interested only in giving the input, nothing but the values that we are storing as part of the data set. And we are interested to know only the output. What kind of outputs you can have? In a machine learning algorithm, what are the different possible outputs you may expect? One could be a continuous value, in which case the output of this will be of the category regression. The second could be a discrete value, in which case the category of algorithm will go on to your classification. Again, in classification, you depending on the number of values you have on your output screen, you may end up with binary value classification or multi-value classification. Only this green and orange color we are interested with. Blue is not what is of our concern. You can have any number of hidden layer. You can have any number of nodes inside the hidden layer. It is up to the system to decide on how to give the best output. I want only the best output. But as a software developer, we should understand how is it being processed inside. That's where this learning. So how is it being processed? So every input node will be assigned a weight depending on the number of hidden nodes you have. In this diagram, I have used only one hidden layer with two nodes inside your hidden layer. So the weights will be initialized at random. The simple multi-linear regression concept will be applied here. So what is multi-linear concept? The output will be computed by summing up the product of your weights along with the attribute values. Let's say x1 into w11 plus x2 into w21 plus xm into wmm plus the bias of the system will be the output of the node h1. The activation function has to be used. You can see here the activation functions are many, but the common activation function that is used in hidden layers will be function tan h, your ReLU likewise. So the activation function will be applied in this layer and the output will again be multiplied using your weights. The outputs of such hidden nodes will be taken and the weights again will be assumed. Again, the weights are random. Now a new bias will be introduced onto the system and hence you are trying to get the output. Again, in this output layer, similar to a single layer perceptron, depending on the type of output you require. If I require, in your Google, by default, it is all, right? All kinds of output will be given to you. If you want to filter out, you can filter whichever you want. Images alone, videos alone, likewise. Here also, it will give number as an output. If you want to improvise the output to fall into any of the class, you can go for sigmoidal activation function. You can go for a sign-based activation function, likewise. So that's how the structure goes on. With this basic understanding, we'll move on for the implementation. So for this, I am going to take banknotes dataset, which is available in Kaggle, And these are the five attributes that is available. So the bank notes are scanned and the variance of the image is stored as one attribute, skewness, kurtosis, entropy. These are the four inputs that are there available on the data set along with the class. It's a binary class valued attribute, and in 0 and 1 will be the output. So as usual, whatever packages we require, we just have imported. I require NumPy and Pandas, and I'm going to read the content and store in a data frame called VNotes. Just in order for us to understand whether it is properly imported, we have printed the first five values. So you can see variance, skewness, kurtosis, entropy are the four attributes along with the output class label called class. In order to understand whether it is a binary valued or multi-valued class attribute, we are using VNotes of class.unique of. It will print how many number of distinct values are there on the class output column, and hence it is 0, 1. Find how many number of rows and columns are there. Shape command is used. So 1372 number of instances are there, and 5 is the number of attributes. Just in order to find whether there are any missing values, how the data is being distributed and all those things, we have described the data set. In all the corresponding attributes, you have 1372 columns, which means there are no missing values and you don't need to trouble yourself in filling up the missing values. Now we are going to divide the data set into input and output data sets. There are a lot many ways to do. Today I have used a very simple method. So X is going to represent the number of input attributes, or not number. X will represent the input attributes. From the data frame, I am going to drop the column called A class. What will happen? The rest of all columns will automatically put together in a different data frame, which is nothing but your X. And I'm going to take only the class, the attribute with class as the attribute name, and I'm going to store it as an output attribute. That's all. We can check, print and check whether it is properly done or. Before proceeding to model training, we are going to divide the data set into training and testing. Train test split is the package that will be imported from sklearn.modelSelection. So the test size which I have used is 70-30. Test size is 30%, and hence training size will go on for 70%. You can modify if you want. And hence we have printed how many datas we have on Xtrain and how many we have on Xtest. Xtest and Ytest remain the same, and hence I have given like this. 960 rows randomly selected will go on for Xtrain, and 412s went on to Ytrain. Once done that, now the next step is to train the model. For training under sklearn, there is a package called neural network. Within that, we have a sub package called multi-layer perceptron classifier, MLP classifier. So to that, we are going to pass some two parameters. Lot many parameters are there, which we'll discuss shortly. But the parameters which I'm going to use is max iteration. How many maximum iteration? Iterations refers to the epochs you are going to permit, because maximum number of iterations set to 500. After 500, if the output is not converging, then that output will be presented to the user. The activation function, what needs to be used at the hidden layers, has to be specified. By default, it is ReLU. Rectified linear unit is what we call as your ReLU activation function. So once having done that, if you print the object name, it will tell you neural net has been trained. Activation function used is ReLU. These are regularization parameter you can leave as of now. Batch size is auto. Batch size we already have seen in a previous example of single layer perceptron. The weight adjustment can be done at any point of time after training the 960 rows, after 100, or after even after one row. How to do that is being determined using your batch size. I am talking only about the parameters that you can understand at this level. Hidden layer size, by default it is 100, meaning that 100 nodes will correspond to the first hidden layer. So you can set this also, hidden layer size. Instead of single hidden layer, you will have two hidden layers. In the first layer, similar to this, you will get 3 nodes, and in the second layer you will get two nodes. That is the meaning of the hidden layer sizes. The learning rate is supposed to be constant within the batch size. So that's what it means. And what is the initialization value? By default, it is 0.001. If you want to have higher learning rates, you can change by setting the parameter. It is 200 is the default maximum iteration. Momentum is again an important parameter which you can make use of to decide the direction of gradient movement. All the weight adjustments are being happening using the gradient descent methodology. So in which direction you want the gradient to move on? Is it in the same direction or in a different direction can be determined using this momentum? By default, it is 0.9. And then what else you can understand now is shuffle is equal to true. By default, it is true. It means that for every epoch, the instances will be shuffled among themselves. The first instance may go to 100, likewise. And then you have solvers. You have different kinds of solver which you can use, the best and the default being the Adam solver. Whatever are the important parameters that you can set as of now, these are the hyperparameters. As we discussed, what is a hyperparameter? Those are the list of parameters which you can vary to improvise the model accuracy. So hidden layer size, you can have it as a tuple. Why is a tuple? Within this parenthesis, you can have any number of values. Length and the total number of hidden layer size length assumed to be n number of layers minus 2, because the first layer will correspond to your input layer and the second layer will correspond to your output layer. By default, it is 100. Activation function. There are different activation function, common being your identity, logistic. Logistic we know, 1 by 1 plus e power minus x. Already we have seen in logistic regression, the same here. Tan h, which is equal to the hyperbolic tan function, that also you can use. This is ReLU, which will return the maximum among the values returned by the output neurons. So that is the most useful or commonly used activation function at the hidden layer nodes. And the third parameter which you can use is learning rate. So learning rate, we know any value between 0 to 1 can be used. You can initialize to a certain value, you can make it constant throughout the epoch, or else you can apply inverse scaling or adaptive depending on the requirement. Maximum number of iteration, by default it is 200, you can increase to any number of iterations. Shuffle, yes, you want the shuffles to be, you want the shuffles to happen inside the epochs, you can set it. Momentum, it is for gradient descent direction movement. And early stopping. Early stopping, when it's set to true, for example, what is the default value of early stopping? It is false. Already we have seen three different kinds of data sets: training data, testing data, and one more is validation data set. So validation data set is part of your training data set, which will be kept aside to understand the betterment of your model. So if you set early stopping to true, what it will do is 10% of your training data will be segregated and it will be taken for validation. So every time when the epoch completes, the validation error will be identified, and if there is no particular improvement in the validation, automatically your iteration will go to end. It is to improvise, or it is to reduce the number of computations that will unnecessarily burden the system. So all these are different hyperparameters that you can set and test. With that, now we are fitting the model using the training input and the training output. And then we are predicting using the testing data. These are the predicted class labels. With that, we are going to print the confusion matrix and the classification report. True positive cases, that is when both your actual and your predicted value is true, 201 output entries are there, and when your actual value is false and your predicted value is false, you have 211 entries. There is not even a single item on the other side. So that's the biggest advantage of your neural network. The precision and recall are both one, which states the fact that this is the best model that can be suited for this corresponding data set. Higher the precision, higher the recall is always appreciable, and hence this model suits the best for your data set.